We're in Mark chapter 11 today, and I invite you to turn there with me in your Bible. And as you're turning there, I want to invite you to consider the timeline, because now we are two-thirds of the way through the Gospel of Mark, so like only a year left before we're done with the series. I counted. We started in September of last year, and I have 38 sermons in the Gospel of Mark so far. You aren't counting, were you? Maybe you were. That's a lot of sermons. Anyway, so we're a third of the way through the Gospel of Mark. And interestingly enough, when we transition into this final third of the Gospel of Mark, we're also looking specifically at the final week of Jesus' earthly ministry. And so what happens here in our text is typically referred to as the triumphal entry. Jesus returned to Jerusalem the week before he was crucified. That happens on a Monday. Jesus would eat the Passover meal. We celebrate communion now, or the Lord's Supper, in honor of that on later in the week. And then traditionally he would have been crucified the following day in the tomb Friday and Saturday, rose again on Sunday morning. And so it's all kind of fascinating to consider the volume of words that are donated to this last week. You have 2 years and 51 weeks in the first two-thirds of the book, and then in this last third, just one week. Interestingly enough, the majority of the Gospel of John is written in the same fashion. The majority of the Gospel of John is written about this last week in Jesus' ministry. So the volume of the work that he does is pretty incredible in these final days before his crucifixion. It's fascinating, not the focus today. The focus is the dynamic of the triumphal entry. And this is an important event, even on the religious calendar. We typically celebrate this event on Palm Sunday, marking the return of Jesus the week before he was crucified, the week before we even now in our calendar celebrate Easter. So what does it mean? What does the triumphal entry mean? Is it, as we celebrate on Palm Sunday, marking the coronation of King Jesus, and we celebrate that every year? Is it the event prophesied in Psalm 24, verses 7 through 10, where David says, "Lift up your heads, O ye gates, so the King of glory may come in"? Or is it a false coronation? People like John MacArthur and other Bible scholars suggest that it is exactly that. Let me read you a quote before we read the text. John MacArthur says this about this passage: "This was not in any sense," and I quote, "the coronation of Jesus Christ. There were no formalities associated with this event, no dignitaries, no regalia, no fanfare." He goes on to say, "Coronations aren't humble, unexpected, spontaneous, unofficial, or superficial. This event was all of those. Nor are true coronations," he says, "reversed a few days afterward with the one who had been exalted and praised being rejected and executed." And so he says this is a false coronation, and I would tend to agree. Whatever it was, whether it was a coronation or not, however you interpret this passage, it was a celebration. People were excited. This was Passover week, and that meant something to the Jews, didn't it? They celebrated their emancipation from 4 centuries of slavery in Egypt every year during Passover week. And they would have this meal where they would roast a lamb in honor of what God did, setting them free, and they would eat it quickly with their sandals on and their robes on and their staff in their hands with bitter herbs, and they would eat it with unleavened bread because they didn't have time to let the bread rise before they baked it, and they would eat that honoring what God did and moving them out of Egypt in haste. They did that every year. So this was a celebration. But there's more to it than that, because of the events that led up to Jesus' triumphal entry. To this event that we celebrate every year on Palm Sunday, I want you to consider with me what happened in the days previous to this. The crowds would have been well aware of what had transpired just a few days before, the Friday before, as a matter of fact, this Monday. Jesus would have made a pit stop in Bethany, John chapter 11, to raise Lazarus from the dead. So that happened in close proximity to the triumphal entry. Before leaving Jericho, before that even, he heals blind Bartimaeus on the road, and he calls the tax collector Zacchaeus to salvation. All of those things we have talked about, at least blind Bartimaeus anyway, in our Gospel of Mark. And so while all this is going on, Jesus' fame is continuing to build, and the religious leaders reach a point where they decide he's got to go. Enough's enough. As a matter of fact, immediately after Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead, the chief priests and the elders take counsel together, and they decide they're going to seek ways to put him to death. They want him out of here. He's got to go. So things have escalated to the point that Jesus could not walk openly among the Jews, and all of that is described at the end of John chapter 11, which means that he didn't go around with the fanfare that he once did when he was in Judea, in Perea, and in Galilee. During this time when hostility is increasing, we also see a change in Jesus. And we notice it in the text. And so, let's read the text. I don't want to get ahead of myself here. Pay attention and allow the Holy Spirit to open your eyes. And I want you to see the change in Christ. If we think back to chapter 10, there was a point when he set his face like a flint to go toward Jerusalem, that he was burdened with that glorious purpose of going to Jerusalem, dying on the cross for the sins of the world, to rise again on the third day, being victorious over death and the grave. And so this weight he is carrying, and we see that again in chapter 11. Now, the Bible says in verse 1, when they drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples. I wonder who they were. We're not told, but two of the disciples and said to them, go into the village in front of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, why are you doing this? Say, the Lord has need of it and will send it back here immediately. And they went and found a colt tied at the door outside in the street, and they untied it. Some of those standing there said to them, what are you doing untying the colt? And they told them that what Jesus had said, and they let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. And many spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. And those who went before and those who followed were shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest. And as he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple, and when he looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. And then if you just look, glance down with me through the rest of the chapter. We're not going to read these verses. We're going to look at them in the next couple Sundays. But when Jesus returns the following morning to Jerusalem, he curses the fig tree. That fig tree dries up at the roots. When he enters the temple, he finds them selling. And they're selling animals to be sacrificed. They're exchanging money for temple money, and they're extorting interest, and there's unbalanced scales, and there's money-making going on and business being transacted. And Jesus gets angry and turns over their money-changing tables and drives out the animals and even drives out those who are conducting business, because they had turned his father's house, which was supposed to be a house of prayer for all nations, into a place of merchandise, into a den of robbers, a den of thieves. But that's not the end of the chapter. As we continue to glance down there, Jesus' authority is challenged, and he stumps them once again. But this time he puts them to an open shame, to the point that they're wondering whether or not they should even ask him any more questions. Remember, they're trying to put him to death. They're trying to find reasons to accuse him and bring him before the governing authorities and have him executed. And he shames them publicly with their questions. And so as we read the text, we see a change in Jesus. Do we not? So all this hostility is increasing. He is bearing the weight of the cross already, and judging by his actions just in this chapter and in the following one, he's on the offense. That he's indignant and angry. Not in a petulant kind of way, but in reality, we see him acting like we would expect a king to act when the king found things that were not to his liking. As I said, not in a petulant way or a spoiled way or an entitled way, but things did not measure up. Things were not as they should be, and he was angry. And all of that makes what happens during the triumphal entry even more fascinating, if we're paying attention. Because as we look at the elements of what transpires as Jesus enters back into Jerusalem and the key players that are involved, all of it puts Jesus on the throne, even though this is a false coronation, something that is overturned in just a few days' time. It puts Jesus on the throne. And when we look at the key players, we learn what it's like, what it looks like to give back to God, to give the king his due. And so we're going to look at three things this morning that teach us about giving back to God and then make some application. In just a few moments, I'm going to ask you to respond by answering three questions. Some of that means you're going to have some homework to do. Some of that means you might have to change your behavior. Some repentance may be involved. May mean you need to come to the altar and pray. But I want you to begin thinking about how you're going to answer these three questions in just a few moments. But as we look back at the text, verses 1 through 11 in Mark chapter 11, and as we look particularly at the triumphal entry and what that teaches us about giving back to God, we see from the disciples that they give their obedience. That's number one. The disciples give the king his due by being obedient. Now let me quickly walk this through with you. The command comes in verses 2 and 3. Jesus tells them to go into the village. They'll find a donkey. They're supposed to untie it and bring it back. If anybody has any questions, you tell them what I said, they'll let you go. It's pretty straightforward, isn't it? And so the details are spelled out with incredible accuracy and specificity. And the disciples, what do? They go. We see that in verses 4 through 7. The command that Jesus gives is carried out. And I find it interesting. They went, and they found it exactly how Jesus said it would be, even at the questioning of their actions. And you know as well as I do that this had to increase their faith, right? Don't you love it when you read something in God's Word and then it happens in our lives exactly the way God said it would happen? That increases our faith, doesn't it? And so the disciples there give their obedience. That's the point of what we're trying to say. And if you think through with me their actions, don't you think this was a little benign for the disciples? After all they've been through? I mean, if this is the last week of Jesus' ministry, think about how this all began almost 3 years ago when Jesus met them at the Sea of Galilee and said, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." And Jesus told Peter to put out and cast his net on the other side of the boat. They'd been fishing all night and caught nothing. And at the word of Jesus, Peter casts his net on the other side of the boat, and the haul of fish is so great that the boat begins to sink and the net begins to break. That's how this all began? Don't you think going to get a donkey might have been a little benign for Peter? A little routine. I mean, at his word, at Jesus' word, storms stopped. Demons were cast out. The powers of darkness shrieked at his word and at his very presence. Going to get a donkey, maybe not such a big deal for them. But I find, and we talked about this in Sunday school concerning David, I find that it is in the benign kind of everyday routine details of life, that's where we struggle the most. It really is, isn't it? We get tripped up by the everyday. We struggle with the mundane and the ordinary. Thinking about David, men, you can verify this who are in our class. David was quick when life was on the line and he was going into battle. Lord, what should I do? Should I go up against the Philistines? Will you give them into my hand? And God was very specific with him. Go up, I've given them into your hand. Do not go up, go around the back instead, and you will rout them from behind. God was very specific about that. But then in the everyday things like his relationship with his wives, we don't see David seeking the Lord like that, do we? Or bringing back the ark into Jerusalem. What am I trying to say? I'm trying to say that we struggle with the everyday. It is the spiritual disciplines of our everyday lives that we struggle with, but yet that is often where God does his work in us. Isn't it? If you think about the volume of your life, the volume of your life, the days of your life are not spent in the extreme or on the mountaintop. They are spent in the day-to-day and in the mundane of going between point A and point B. And by the way, that is where Jesus told us to carry out the Great Commission. Go and make disciples. As you're going about your lives, as you're going about the everyday, it's not an event, it's not an extreme, it's something that we do, it's how we live our lives. And while it may be a struggle, the discipline of the ordinary and the obedience that we carry out in the ordinary is where God commonly does the most of his work in us, and interestingly enough, that is where the volume of our faith grows. And so the disciples give their obedience in something that seems like benign circumstances. Secondly, we learn about giving the king his due, giving back to God from the owners of this donkey. And the owners give their donkey. That's number two. And I know that seems self-evident from the passage. It's almost comical, a little satirical. But they willingly give what they have to be used by Jesus to accomplish his mission. This is an important concept for us when it comes to giving the king his due, to giving back to God. Think this through with me. Jesus knew exactly what they had to give, didn't he? And by the way, he knows exactly what you have to give too. This is what the Apostle Paul explains as a willingness or a readiness of heart in 2 Corinthians 8, chapter 8 and verse 12. Jesus knows what you have to give, and he knows what you don't. He doesn't expect you to give what you don't have. I mean, that's pretty self-evident, isn't it? But sometimes we get so caught up in that, we wrestle with whether or not we have it to give or whether or not we don't, and the faith to give it and the faith not to give it. Let's just rest in the fact here and from this text, Jesus knows what you have, right? He knew what they had. And by the way, he knew where they had it. He knew where they would find it. He knew where to find the resources that he needed to accomplish his mission. It's that simple. And that is an interesting thought when you think about it, when it relates to giving back to God. Jesus doesn't know just what you have, but he knows where to find what he needs to accomplish his mission. God is never worried about resources. Isn't that an interesting concept? We're the one that worry, right? We're worried about how we're going to pay our bills personally and how we're going to make ends meet and how we're going to pay for this and how we're going to accomplish this and blah-bitty, blah-bitty, blah. You know, X, Y, Z, you put it on a spreadsheet, see if it adds up on paper. We're worried about resources. And we kind of do that here to some extent, do we not? I mean, we want to be good stewards, and so we're trying to manage what God entrusts to us, and we're trying to do that in a way that glorifies him and to the best of our ability use those resources well. But God's not worried about resources. He owns the cattle upon a thousand hills. At his word, he upholds the universe. You think God's worried about resources? He knows exactly where to find what he needs to accomplish his mission. And by the way, he has placed those strategically in his kingdom, in the hands of people who will willingly give it to him to accomplish his mission. And that's where we find the owners. He knew exactly what would happen. By the way, this is letter B here. Letter A is Jesus knew what they had. Letter B is he knew, by the way, where it was. And letter C, he knew exactly what would happen when they gave it, when he asked for it. We're worried about what's going to happen after we turn loose of something. Can we be honest about that? God asks us for a tithe. We're worried about what we're going to do, what's going to happen if we turn loose of the tithe. Right? Be honest. God asks us on a mission Sunday to give a little extra. We're worried about what's going to happen when we turn loose of it. And by the way, this isn't just a monetary thing. If God is asking us to part with some of our stuff, we're worried about what's going to happen if we have to part with it. If we're worried about what's going to happen if we give our lives to be spent to build his kingdom. What if we turn loose of this? What is going to happen if we turn loose of what God is asking for? And by the way, God knows exactly what's going to happen when we turn loose of it. That's what happens here in this text. Those standing by in Mark, Luke 19:33 calls them the owners of the donkey. They had their questions, didn't they? They wanted to know what was going on, so they didn't unquestioningly give it, but they willingly gave it once they understood. They unflinchingly gave it once they understood that it was the will of God. Without hesitation, they turned loose. Jesus knew that would happen. And so I'm challenged here by our giving, and we're going to talk more about this in just a moment. But for now, let's think about how this relates to us. God knows what you have. He's not going to ask you to give something that you don't have. He knows where to find the resources to accomplish his mission, which means he's not going to ask you to give something that you don't have, that he's not entrusted to you to give back to him. And he knows exactly what's going to happen when you turn loose of it. This is where faith kicks in. This is where we find ourselves as the owners of this donkey. And our faith ought to be challenged to be like them as we give the king his due. Give God, not unquestioningly. God tells us what's going to happen, but willingly, as a readiness of heart to give him what he wants and what he needs. All right? As a side note, it may seem strange to us that Jesus wants a donkey. Does that seem strange to anybody besides me? Especially considering what is going on, that he's going to ride a donkey back into Jerusalem with some kind of fanfare, and that somehow this marked his triumphal entry and this would be a sign of his kingship. Donkeys are beasts of burden. They're not regal animals, are they? They're kind of humble, and so why does Jesus want a donkey? So it may seem strange or even humiliating even that Jesus wants to ride a donkey back into Jerusalem. There's some significance to it, something cultural to it, and something that we need to understand. So let me just, as a side note, give this to you quickly, not to be overlooked. Traditionally, if you were a Middle Eastern king, this was the animal that you rode as an ambassador of peace. If you were going to fight, you rode a stallion. But if you were going in peace, you went on a donkey. And so compare this image now as Jesus goes back to Jerusalem, not to conquer, but to die for the sins of the world, to the image of Jesus returning at his second coming, riding upon a what? A great white horse, with the armies of heaven following on their white horses, mounted for battle, the sword of his word proceeding out of his mouth. What a stark contrast to this image. And what does that tell us about Jesus? that he does not come in this time to conquer, but as a messenger from God to bring peace and salvation to the world. It's very, very important, right? And then there are other things going on here. There are other subtle nuances going on here. Religiously, animals that were given to God in sacrifice could never have been used. Firstborn, those that opened the womb, were given to God to be sacrificed to God. They weren't to be used for any other purpose. And so this animal, by the way, had never been ridden, had never been used. So it's an appropriate gift, sacrifice to God. What is more, it shows the power of God in his creation, Jesus' power over his creation. He was able to ride and control an animal that had never been broken. If this animal had never been ridden, it had never been broken. It had never had a bit in its mouth. It had never been trained. And yet Jesus is able to ride it into Jerusalem, and that shows his power, does it not? Royally, by the way, also, this is interesting too, as king, no one could ride the king's animal but the king. And so again, we see that no one had ever sat on this colt. And so royally, it meant something. It's also a persuasive argument, for Davidic succession. Even the people, as they see this, say, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," and they call out to Jesus as the Son of David, that he is fulfilling the Davidic covenant, riding this donkey into Jerusalem. So this becomes an argument for Davidic succession. This is an image that bears the mark of Solomon ascending the throne and assuming the throne of his father David. Read 1 Kings 19:33 on your own time, or 1:33, excuse me. Read that passage where Solomon is placed upon David's mule to ride to his coronation. Very interesting when you consider all of that. And all of that says this to us. Let me bring this home to you, okay? We don't need to get lost in the details, but let me bring this home. It was ingrained in Israel's consciousness that their king would come to them riding on a donkey. That Jesus, in so doing this, was fulfilling prophecy concerning himself. He was actively and intentionally fulfilling Zechariah 9:9, which said, "Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey." Zechariah 9:9. And so that would have been well known to the people. And by the way, it probably had everything to do with why they willingly turned loose of it. The king needs it. He can have it. And so the owners willingly give their donkey. The disciples willingly give their obedience. And then there's also the onlookers, the people that line the roads and that offer Jesus their praise. And so the onlookers give Jesus their praise. Again, self-evident from the passage. But think this through with me, because this is interesting. By way of illustration, there's a couple of sporting events that I geek out about throughout the year. One is the Masters. And if you don't know what the Masters is, I don't know what rock you've been living under. But anyway, it's the greatest golf tournament of the year. And the other is the Tour de France, which happens to be going on right now, as a matter of fact. And this year particularly, it's been very interesting. Some injuries leading up to it, remove some of the key players, and it's been wide open. And the interesting thing about this particular Tour de France is that there's been a Frenchman leading the race throughout its entirety, except for just a couple of days at the beginning of the race. And so throughout the race, you have people lined on the side of the road. And yesterday, as they were going up the Galibier, which is a mountain in southern France, there were literally thousands of people lining the roads, and there was barely enough room for one person on a bicycle to get through it. Did anybody watch it or see it? See it on the news? Okay, I'm the only one. I'm a weirdo, I guess. And it's amazing. They've got banners in their hands. They're taking pictures. They're setting off smoke bombs. There's fireworks. And in my mind's eye, that's kind of how I see the road from Bethany to Jerusalem, lined with people shouting, Hosanna, closing in upon Jesus. And the Bible says that in the midst of all of this, in the midst of all of that fanfare, they put their garments on this donkey so that Jesus could ride on it, kind of like a saddle blanket almost. That's an act. There are three symbolic acts that honor Jesus as king. That's the first one. The second one is they lay their garments on the road. And that seems strange to us. But when you are welcoming a king in that day and age, that's what you did. It was a sign of chivalry. You were honoring your guest, that he was royal and above you. He was to be respected and honored. So you laid your cloak on the ground so that even the very animal that he rode on didn't have to tread upon the dirt. And then they cut palm branches and branches from the fields. More than likely, they were olive branches and palm branches. They laid them on the ground and they fanned Jesus. This was common when Jehu was anointed king, they did the same thing to him in the book of 1 Kings. They'll do it again at the second coming of Christ. They will honor Jesus by fanning him as he traveled on the way. And in all of it, these three symbolic acts point to Jesus, and they honor Jesus as royalty, as the king. And then there were also three expressions of praise. At the end of our text, you see them crying out, Hosanna. We sang about that a moment ago. What does Hosanna mean? It is a Hebraic expression of praise. It means, Lord, save us now. Lord, save us now. It gives voice to their hope. Their hope that was wrapped up in the coming of Messiah. The hope that a king would come to them in the successive line of kings from David. It had been several centuries since they'd had a king. And so as they say, Lord, save us now, they are pointing to Jesus and acknowledging him as Messiah, son of David, come to save them, that he was king. And their cries offer a kingly reception to Jesus. And according to them, at least at this moment anyway, he was welcome there. They were glad to have him. But in just a few days, the praise of these same people would turn into jeers before Pilate. That in just a few days, these same people who were singing Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest, would cry, crucify him, crucify him. We have no king but Caesar. Why does that break your heart like it breaks mine? The fickle nature of the crowd. We've seen that in our study thus far, but why the turnaround? Why would they go from crying out, Hosanna, Hosanna, giving Jesus their praise, acknowledging him as the king, giving him his due, to rejecting him and demanding his death? Why? Could it be that they were confused? That when they cried out, Hosanna, they weren't pleading for salvation? That they had somehow gotten the timeline mixed up? That Jesus would come to reign at his second coming, but now he came to die for the sins of the world, that he must die before he could reign? He must save people from their sins before he could sit as sovereign? And so they expected deliverance from the Romans. They wanted a king to sit upon the throne, not a savior to die upon a cross. And so their confusion led to their hostile rejection. Nonetheless, don't you find it interesting that Jesus let them go right on shouting? That even the Pharisees, when they got involved, if you read the parallel accounts in Luke's gospel and in Matthew's gospel, that the Pharisees come to Jesus and they say, you make these people be quiet. And he said, if they hold their peace, even the rocks will cry out. And Jesus understood he was worthy of that kind of reception and worthy of that kind of praise. And that's not self-exalting. That simply attributes the fact that he is God the Son. That he was exactly who Jesus is, who he claimed to be. Right? And he let them go right on shouting, affirming his kingship as the Son of David. So now, let's make some application. I'm out of time. Let me hurry quickly, okay? What does all this mean? I asked you to begin thinking about what this means, and now we're going to answer. Now we're going to answer three questions here quickly as we apply. So as we look at the disciples who gave their obedience and the owners who gave their donkey, what they had, and the onlookers who gave their praise, let's begin first by asking ourselves this question. What is Jesus asking us to do? Let's make it personal. What is Jesus asking me to do? As I address you, what is Jesus asking you to do? As we said earlier, the discipline of ordinary, everyday obedience is where God most commonly does his work in us. So what does that mean? I think there are some of you that God might ask you to do something special and extraordinary. He might be burdening your heart to do that right now. But I rather imagine this will be carried out in the everyday and in the ordinary. That for some of you it might mean, because this is where our faith grows the most, it might mean that you need to be more committed to daily spiritual disciplines of prayer and Bible reading. That those priorities need to take center stage in your life rather than the other things that you've allowed to crowd them out. That's where God's going to most commonly do his work in you. Hello? What is Jesus asking you to do? You know, some of you may have been wrestling with something for a long time. And now you know very clearly what that is. That the Holy Spirit, who convicts the world of sin and righteousness and judgment to come, is speaking to your heart right now about what that is. What is Jesus asking you to do? How can you give him your obedience? And then here's the second question. When we need to make this personal, as I address you, what is Jesus asking you to give? What is Jesus? You ask it of yourself. I ask it of myself. What is Jesus asking me to give? Remember, he knows what you have. He knows where to find the resources to accomplish his mission, and he knows what's going to happen when you give it. And he's, listen to me. If he's asking you to give something, he is not worried about your resources. He will provide abundantly and supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Philippians 4:19. He's going to take care of you. If you seek the kingdom first and his righteousness, all those things that we worry about, he's promised to provide. And so he's not worried about your resources. And so what does that mean? When we ask this question, what is he asking me to give? Maybe some of you, he's asking you to begin trusting him with your money and begin tithing. I think that's a pretty self-evident application, isn't it? That you'll trust Jesus with all of your money and begin tithing. Maybe it's not financial. Maybe it's material, and that he's asking you to part with some of your stuff. And all of us don't like to have our stuff messed with. You know? I'm fine as long as nobody messes with my stuff. But maybe Jesus wants to mess with your stuff. And maybe he wants you to sell some of that stuff. Or to give some of that stuff away to somebody who could use it or to somebody who needs it. Maybe it's not any of that. Maybe it's your time that he wants you to give. That's the most precious resource of all, isn't it? All of us have the same amount of time. None of us have any more time than anyone else. We all have 24 hours in a day, and not one of us is promised tomorrow. And so maybe Jesus simply wants you to stop spending so much time on yourself and spend some more time investing in His kingdom, building His kingdom, making disciples. Maybe it's your skill set that's needed. Maybe He's gifted you with something and He's placed you in the body, and the body needs that gift to function and to be healthy and to flourish. Maybe He's asking you to give that gift to Him. And instead of using it for your own self-exaltation and your own self-gratification, use it instead to build His kingdom. Maybe. God knows, right? He knows what you have to give. And He knows what's going to happen when you turn loose of it. And so what is He asking you to give? To be used by Him in the service of His kingdom. And then here's our last question. How might we give Him our praise this morning? How might we honor Him and give Him His due? Does it start with some of you with your own cry of Hosanna, Lord, save me? That maybe your praise begins with your salvation. That you need to trust Jesus completely with your eternal soul for the forgiveness of your sins. Maybe it starts there. Perhaps He's calling you to be more active in corporate worship. And instead of being a witness, being a participant. Now listen, you have my sympathy here if you feel like you can't sing. And this isn't just about singing. I don't feel like I can carry a tune in a bucket. But I do know this, even though I can't sing in a way that anybody else wants to hear, God wants to hear it. Right? And so instead of sitting with my arms folded and watching others sing and listening to others sing, I have a responsibility to sing. Because God is listening. Hello? And so maybe instead of being a witness, you need to be a participant. And God is calling you to be more active in corporate worship. But maybe your praise isn't needed here. Maybe it's needed at home. And that you need to praise the Lord at home. That worship needs to take center stage in your home. And I know what that looks like. I have two kids. I'm trying to live life just like you. And if I'm not careful, you know what crowds worship out in my home? Me. But I want to kick back and relax, and I want to check out. I want to be entertained. I want to eat. I want to do what I want to do. And I push all that to the peripheral. I'll do it if it occurs to me. Or if I feel like it. But if we're going to give our praise to Jesus, worship needs to take center stage at home, too. Amen? I know I'm messing with your stuff now, but listen. That's an application from this passage. And there's another one. Maybe it's needed at work. You know, we've been told by culture that we can't say anything. We're convinced that if we say something, somehow everything that we hold on to is in jeopardy. And there may be some environments where that's a little more precarious than others, and I want to give place to that. But I think your worship still can take center stage in your workplace without you browbeating people with your Bible. That you can be salt and light in a dark place without bringing reproach upon yourself. Right? And by the way, that's what's needed in our world. We need people to go worship at work, to treat their job, no matter what it is, first as worship, then as a means of providing for yourself. That we can do whatever it is with joy because we do it first as an offering of praise to Jesus. Jesus wants that kind of praise. He deserves that kind of praise. He's worthy of that kind of praise. And the world needs to see that kind of praise. It's a wonderful witness for the power of the gospel. So, what is Jesus asking you to do? What might he be asking you to give? How might you give him your praise this morning? Father, help us to be obedient to that which we've heard. I need you to increase my faith so that I can obey. I want to be obedient, Lord. You're worthy of my obedience. Help me to obey, not just in the big things where it's clear, but in the discipline of the everyday, ordinary, those things where you work in me most. May that be true of all of us. Help me to be generous. You've been so good to me. How can I not give back to you what you've asked me to? Whatever that gift might be, my skills, my time, my energy, my stuff, my money, all of it belongs to you. Lord, help us to be generous, willingly give to you what you ask of us. Lord, you're worthy of our praise. If there's one here today that needs to be saved, may their worship of you begin today with their salvation. May we worship here, at home, and at work, because you're worthy, Lord. In Jesus' name. Let's stand to our feet. Fawn's going to sing through a song of invitation. If you need to pray, the altars are open. Let's do business with God as we close out and worship.